السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Four days of lectures, four days of speeches, four days of scholars, gems and pearls have been compiled, wisdoms have been gathered, imans have soared high. And me personally, I have benefited immensely from many, many factors. But one phrase I will always remember for the rest of my life. Brother Ahmed's statement, Sheikh speak too much. Sheikh speak too much and all they do is speak. Putting me right on the spot, at the end of these 4 days of speeches and lectures, I have the dubious and unfortunate honor of being the last speaker out of all of these speakers, and all they want me to do is speak. Allahu musta'an. How do I get out of this one? So, inshallah ta'ala, I'll try to make this as short as possible because we don't want Sheikh to speak too long. And I do want to say, I have no prepared speech at all, but I do want to say that subhanAllah, when I listened to their presentation on the Muslims in Trinidad, wallahi, one hadith came to mind. A hadith that really and truly, it comes to light when you see these type of presentations and hear these facts. And that is a hadith that the Prophet ﷺ said to a small group of Muslims in Medina who had yet to conquer, forget Arabia, even the surrounding areas. They were oppressed by the Muslims or by the pagans of Mecca. They have no idea what the future will hold for them. And yet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith reported in Sahih Muslim and others, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى زَوَى لِيَ الْأَرْضَ فَرَأَيْتُ مَشَارِقَهَا وَمَغَارِبَهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rolled the earth up for me. He rolled it up for me. And so I saw the easternmost point and the westernmost point. From east to west I was able to see it. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and my ummah shall reach the easternmost point as it shall reach the westernmost point. And this is exactly what we see. Who even knows where Trinidad and Tobago is? Who's even, with all due respect to our brother? One person would be able to identify it on a map. Imagine this small island, even a few hundred years ago. Who would have thought that there would be so many masajids, full-time schools being built, curriculums of Islamic education being enacted in a small island in the middle of the ocean, in the middle of the Caribbean? This is what you call the Ummah of Islam. Who could have possibly known except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then through the knowledge of the Prophet given to him by Allah, we were informed of this as well. The Ummah is alive and well, as our brother said. The Ummah is alive and well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will indeed protect it. And yet, we also know of all of the sad occurrences that are occurring in the Muslim world. In fact, the times that we live in, for the most part, are depressing times. We all know this as well. Yes, we hear these rays of hope, these lights of sun that come in and lift our spirits. But the reality then strikes after that. We'll open the news tomorrow, surf the internet, read the newspapers, and we'll hear of something else happening in a faraway Muslim land, or maybe even something close to home. And depression hits home. You feel that there's no hope, it's hopeless. But realize, O Muslim, that this feeling of despair, this feeling of hopelessness, if it's there for a temporary while, it might be overlooked. But it cannot be there forever. An incident comes to mind, similar, or actually much worse, but it gives us hope. And that is the incident of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he went to Al-Ta'if. All of you know the incident, that after 10 or 13 years of da'wah in Mecca, being unsuccessful amongst the people of Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for the first time, journeys to the neighboring city of Al-Ta'if. For the first time, opens up his da'wah to other borders, going to other cities. And he is rejected, a humiliating rejection. And the people pelt him with stones. And he is bleeding and running away. The hadith or the narration says, I lost consciousness of where I was. meaning I wasn't aware of what's going on until I reached a place, and he mentioned the name of the place, which is 5 miles outside of Taif. For 5 miles, the Prophet ﷺ was wandering away from Taif, and he had no clue what was happening. He said, I didn't understand what was going on. In other words, he was in shock, we call it in our times. He was in shock. This was the immediate effect of the direct and harsh persecution. Bleeding, stones pelted, humiliating rejection. Of course, it is human nature to react in this manner. But what happens right after the shock? Right after the shock, he sits down under the shade of a tree. And Addas comes to him, a slave who was a Christian. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam starts giving him da'wah. And in a few minutes, Addas embraces Islam. The shock of what happened in Taif did not prevent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from seeing in front of him another potential, another possible Muslim, another opportunity for da'wah, another chance for change. He did react to Taif. It is not that Taif was ignored. And when Aisha asked him, what was the worst time of your life that you ever faced? He said, it was my rejection at Taif. So he reacted. And he reacted in shock. But he went over and he overcame that reaction. He overcame that shock. And he then started doing the da'wah and being the proactive prophet that he was. We have a great and profound lesson to learn from this incident in the seerah. And that is that no doubt, many incidents that occur in our communities, a person that we might have known is framed and sent to jail. Another person is deported. In our national arena, civil laws are being stripped. We are being harassed in the airports and this and that. In the international arena, what is happening in Iraq and all of these countries, no doubt, if we have iman, we are going to be sad. Wallahi, if we're not sad, this is a lack of iman. We're going to feel a tinge of depression. But the real mu'min understands and realizes and utilizes that depression, that sadness, to do something. Whereas the person weak in faith allows that depression to remain and linger, and then grow and increase until finally the person reaches a state of despair and does absolutely nothing. This is what we must avoid, O Muslims. This is what we must avoid. We all know the pitiful state of the Ummah, and yes, it is a pitiful state, even though there have been states that are more worse than we are in right now. As for example, when the brother said the Mongols attack. When the Mongols attacked, it was actually more of a fitna and more of a chaos for the Ummah than the present situation. But we overcame it, and we will overcome this time as well. Insha'Allah, tahqiq and la ta'liq, and this will happen because this is a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the point being, what will we do to cause that change? What will we do to cause that change? The brother quoted, the Shaykh quoted the verse in the Quran, which all of us know, that Allah does not change the status of a people until they change what is in themselves. Change begins with me, and change begins with you. If I don't change and you don't change, no one and nothing will change. So the change must be something that is tangible, realistic, and practical. One of the problems that we have as a ummah is that we look at Iraq, we look at Palestine, we hear of the bombings in Lebanon and this and that, and we think, what can I possibly do to help the Muslims in Palestine? I can't stop them against this naked Zionist aggression. I can't do anything. But you see, here is where your problem was. Who said that you single-handedly are responsible to save the entire ummah? When you have made it your goal to affect an entire nation, to change the course of international history, of course you're going to fail, and of course you're going to get despondent and feel, what can I do? This was the problem. Instead of thinking, how can I solve the Palestine crisis? In all honesty, perhaps there is nothing I can do or you can do to solve that crisis or any other major crisis. Rather, we should think in a different light. What can I do to benefit the Ummah? Even if I don't solve all of its problems, what can I as an individual do to benefit the Ummah? Every single one of us has a unique talent, a unique opportunity, a unique something or other that they can do. Every one of us, think about it, has a different circle of friends, a different sphere of influence. No human being on the face of this earth knows the exact same people to the same level you do. Your level of influence and da'wah is unique to you. Therefore, who will take your place in this arena of da'wah except you? No human being has the faults and weaknesses and strengths and powers and skills and sins that you do. Realize what you can do and be practical and proactive. Don't think about changing the ummah. Think about what can I do to better the ummah. And when we think in this way, then wallahi, the whole paradigm, the whole matter changes. Look around you in your own community. See what weaknesses there are. And see what you can do to fill in that gap. And don't think that no change will occur. Change will occur, even if you only change. How is this so? When you change for the better, it is not possible that you will not cause an effect upon others. Think back to a person who had an influence in your life. Brother Ahmed mentioned the sheikh of his masjid. It is very likely possible that that sheikh was not practicing for his whole life also. But he became practicing. And one conversation changed the life of another Muslim. What did the imam or the sheikh know of this conversation and what would happen? He didn't know what's going to happen, but it had an effect. Similarly, when you change, your spouse will see that change. Your children will see that change. Your neighbors, your relatives, your community, your co-workers will see that change. Surely, some of them, if not all, are going to change for the better. So you will start a domino effect. And also realize, as I said and I alluded to, perhaps you will not be able to see the effects of that change immediately. You won't be able to see a cataclysmic change in the world situation because you changed for the better. But the parable that I give is that of a room engulfed in darkness. Imagine if this room right here were engulfed in darkness right now. Utter and pitch darkness. We have two options. Either we can say, we'll wait for somebody to find the light switch and turn it on. I don't know where it is, I'll just sit here. Or we say, what can I do? What can I do? I might not find the lights for the entire room, but can I do something? So he has a lighter, he pulls it out, and he lights that lighter. Another person sees this lighter, and he lights a match. And a third person lights a small torch. And when finally you have hundreds of people with small lights, what will happen to the room around you? It will shine bright and light. One individual light, you would think, makes no difference. But the reality is, all of the light of the room is based upon these individual lights. This is the parable of the ummah. This is how we need to think of ourselves. Don't think that you will light the entire room up. Perhaps you won't. And by the way, maybe you will. When Salahuddin al-Ayyubi was born, and he was playing in the streets of Tikrit, he grew up in Tikrit, Iraq. When he was playing basketball, whatever they used to play back then, in the streets of Tikrit, definitely not basketball, but they must have had their own games. Do you really think that he realized who he was going to become? Do you really think that he thought, I will single-handedly, with the help of Allah, change the course of history? Of course not. He was an average person with an average childhood. Everything was average. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him, and he stood up to the challenge, and he went higher and higher until his name is upon the tongues of every single Muslim on the face of this earth. And how do you know you might not be the next Salahuddin al-Ayyubi? How do you know you might not be the next Ibn Hajar ibn Taymiyyah? How do you know this? So you don't. Don't trivialize your role in the ummah of Muslims. Don't trivialize it. Every one of you has a role to play. All you have to do is think, what can I do for the ummah? And you know, in the end of the day, if you really and truly are not going to cause a change as you hope for, you're not going to cause this revolution, you just change for the better for yourself, at least you would have saved yourself from the punishment of Allah. At least you would have entered Jannah because of your own change. And is that not a sufficient reason for the change? Talks and lectures are only the means and not the goal. Talks and lectures are only means. We've come to this convention, we've spent a few days here, we all love the environment, we all love the brotherhood, we are all going to miss this Islamic environment. All of us, without exception, have benefited, some more than others, knowledge-wise and Islamic-wise. The question comes now, what will we do after the convention is over? Will we return to the same state we were before? Or will we be a little bit more conscious, a little bit more iman, a little bit more taqwa comes into our lives? This is all that is required of us. O Muslims, I conclude by quoting a verse of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يُرِيدُونَ لِيُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ بِأَفْوَاهِهِمْ. They wish to destroy the light of Allah Islam is the light of Allah, and this ummah is a manifestation of that light. So they wish to destroy this light with their tongues. وَاللَّهُ مُتِمُّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. And of a surety, Allah will perfect His light even if the disbelievers don't like this. Oh, brothers and sisters in Islam, don't be worried for the ummah. Allah will protect this ummah. This is a guarantee from Allah. Worry about yourselves. Worry about me. Worry about you. The ummah will be protected. But will you? Will you save yourself from the punishment of Allah? And will you manage to enter Jannah through your own deeds and the mercy of Allah? That is the ultimate question. That is the only question that is of concern to us. Wa akhiru da'wana. And alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. I hope to see you all next year. And maybe even between that, inshaAllah ta'ala. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allahu Akbar!
Allahu Akbar!
Takbir!
Allahu Akbar!
Sunnah, Sheikh.